Good evening, and thank you so much all for being with us. And now we're going to start our today's session. I'm Debulina from Clearnet. We are very much proud to be a part of this webinar as a digital partner. As you all know, Clearnet is India's largest live digital CME and doctors-generated medical content platform. So we'll invite all the doctors to visit our website, which is www.clearnet.com. So now, without further delay, I would like to hand over the session to Dr. Jayashree Sood, ma'am, to start with the program. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Debulina. Good evening, everybody. It's a great honor for me to be welcoming all of you to the 103rd episode of the ICA webinars, which have been running very successively and very consecutively with no break at all, and have become very popular with the students and other faculty. Before, of course, today's webinar, the title is Anaesthesiology and Essentials of Research. But before I introduce our esteemed moderator and our speakers, I would like to make two announcements. And they are, the most important one is the ICA Con 2022, which is going to be held this year in November, from the 4th to 6th November in Chandigarh. And this is being hosted by the Government Medical College, Sector 32, Chandigarh. Dr. Sukanya Mitra is the organizing chairperson. And this is going to be the third international and 13th annual national conference of the Indian College of Anesthesiologists. It has a very attractive theme, which is technology in anesthesia, science with a human face. And I'm sure this is a very attractive conference, and we would expect all of you and like to see you all there. And of course, this is the first announcement. Details will be coming later. The second important announcement that I'd like to make, of course, is what you've been seeing, what we have been highlighting in the last 2 minutes. And this is our very special second annual ICA webinar celebration that is going to be held on the 13th of July at 7 p.m. at the same time. And this is, of course, the second why we're saying, because we started in 2020. And we have a very interesting program over here. Of course, it will be starting at 7 p.m., where not only our ICA president and ICA chairperson and the CEO and the president will be talking, but also it is the ISA president, the ISA national secretary that of ours, Dr. Naveen, as well as the ASA president, past president, the president will all be there. And we have a very interesting session where all the ISA state presidents will be giving their views on certain hot topics. So coming back to today, it's my pleasure to introduce our moderator, Dr. Rakesh Garg, for this very vibrant webinar, which is Anesthesiology and Essentials of Research. And I'm not surprised that we have Dr. Rakesh as our moderator. He is very, very young, but he has a very elaborate CV. He has over 260 publications, 25 chapters, editors in several journals, as well as associate editor. As of now, he's an additional professor in the Department of Onco-Anesthesiology and Palliative Medicine at the All India Institute, the Onco Wing, as well as he has had, of course, held many conferences, and he's attended many and held many workshops. His area of interest is, of course, onco-anesthesia, airway research, cancer pain, palliative medicine, and of course, he's an ardent teacher and a very active member of both the ISA and the ICA. So, Dr. Rakesh, please go ahead and start the webinar. Thank you
so much for your kind words and giving this opportunity as well to be part of this prestigious ICA webinar series. So today we'll be discussing about research, because many of the times we talk about p-values majority of time when we try to interpret the data that we have. And more recently, we have been talking about the confidence interval. So I'll be focusing on those two aspects for next around 20 minutes or so. I bring greetings from my institute, Indian Institute of Medical Sciences. I work at Cancer Center of the Institute. So let me take you to the research process cycle, because when we want to do some research, we usually base on our experience and some limitation. We review the literature, formulate a research question, set up an appropriate design, and then collect the relevant data. And then this data has to be interpreted. Now, these are the two aspects probably we'll be touching today, that when we interpret this data after the analysis, what exactly p-value and confidence interval stands for us, so that when we publish it or somebody else wants to reinterpret or read our article, which will be again dealt in detail by the subsequent speaker, Dr. Anju Grewal, as well, how we can interpret appropriately and why we are talking about nowadays confidence interval also should be a part of our analysis. As we all know, just to put up a little brief to start with, when we start a study, we think of a research question, and definitely this PICOT, everybody of us knows it very well, that our research question should stand and complete the various component of PICOT, that is study population, intervention, control arm, outcome, and timing of measurement of outcome. This remains the basic aspect before we start a study, and that's why based on our experience for some clinical requirement, based on review of literature, we start preparing a PICOT question, research question, and usually the research question, the primary research question, is usually put as one question based on which we calculate the sample size, because this is based on the primary objective that is derived from our main research question that we are looking for. And this sample size is primarily based on the primary objective itself. And the we are looking for the various things like effect size, and then based over of an understanding or based on the previous published data, we take it forward for looking for the things further on. And when we talk of the sample size is important from two aspects. One is, when we are planning the protocol, we should be aware that how many subjects are necessary to estimate a parameter with a specified precision. So I'll be coming with each words that I'm using here a little detail subsequently. That is, how many subjects I need to enroll into my study in order to answer my research question. So this is one thing that we'll be looking for. I'm putting this way because subsequently, when we're talking about the p-value, this will matter, that when we say a sample size, a small sample size or a large sample size. So what exactly the sample size is, and when we interpret the data, we need also to explain that does the study has adequate precision or power for the reported results. Sometimes we do the analysis of secondary objectives. Sometimes we tend to do some subgroup analysis, or we make subgroups and then try to analyze those data from those. So this means in some way we have to understand that the p-value that is obtained from this analysis, whether we can very definitely say that are they answering the research question that we have explained in the beginning, and the primary question was something different. The next aspect in the study is the hypothesis. This is a procedure for making inferences about a population. And when we say hypothesis testing, it allows us to determine whether enough statistical evidence exists to conclude that a belief, that is what we have hypothesized about a parameter, that is what we are thinking of, is supported by the data. And this is what we test and make on the research, based on the research question, as null hypothesis or an alternate hypothesis. Null hypothesis means we assume that there is no statistically significant difference between the two groups with respect to the outcome, and usually we try to reject this null hypothesis to reach to a conclusion. And we put an alternate hypothesis also, where we see that there is a statistically significant difference between two groups with respect to the outcome. And then we go on further as per the study protocol for testing this hypothesis, and that's why we have a sequence of steps which is elaborated in the method section, and then we do a statistical analysis for these patients and try to interpret. When we try to interpret, once the data is collected, we put them into either a descriptive statistics, where we just try to summarize our data in form of, say, mean, median, or a similar way. And then we try to have some inferential statistics, wherein we try to analyze or compare the data among the groups and try to have some inference with regards to the comparison between these aspects, which may be generalization or certainty. That is what is we are trying to create or get some inference from the collected data, that what we have thought of in the beginning as a research question, we are trying to answer here by getting this inferential statistics. When we talk about the descriptive, usually sometimes we use mean standard deviation or median or mode or counts and proportion. Just to have a brief understanding, if the data is normally distributed, we use mean. If it is a non-parametric data, usually we use median into our study. And then we do try to do a statistical analysis. Usually these are based on four basic parameters, and based on this, whether we are comparing categorical with categorical or categorical with quantitative or even with quantitative versus quantitative, we try to apply these tests, which may be the chi-square test or McNamara test or student t-test or pair t-test or one-way ANOVA or repeated measures ANOVA. So it depends upon the basic four parameters of the type of variables we have, the study design we have, whether the data is related or unrelated, and based on this we try to apply these tests to reach a value. But we need to remember that we need to understand, or when we are analyzing the published data, that an appropriate test has been applied, because the computer-based programs may not be able to check the tests you are applying it. You have to select from them, and then if you apply a wrong test, there will be no significance of whatever the subsequent inference that you are taking out of it. The p-value may not be getting its significance for its understanding. Now, having said that, you have the data, analyze it, and then you start thinking of making an inference. Now, these are the two terminologies which we'll be talking about in the next 15 minutes or so. But we talk about making inferences, usually we use p-values and the confidence interval. Now, if you see the published studies nowadays, yes, p-value is given as a measure of statistical probability in certain studies. While certain studies, you will find that they're using confidence interval, usually the 95% confidence interval. And more recently, you'll find that certain data, they report both the things, the 95% confidence interval as well as the p-value. Now, what exactly these two terminologies stands for? The p-value determines whether a null hypothesis that we have initially thought of is to be accepted or rejected. And in exploratory studies, p-values enable the recognition of any statistically noteworthy findings. On the other hand, if you talk about the confidence interval, it provides information about a range in which the true value. Now, you just keep a note of true value, because what we are doing is the calculated values may not be the true value. The range in which the true value lies with a certain degree of probability, as well as about the direction and strength of the demonstrated effect. I'll be coming in detail a little later. And this enables us to conclude about the statistical plausibility and clinical relevance of the study findings. Again, I'll be explaining these things in subsequent slides. So this means when we talk about the p-value, it answers, is there a statistical significant difference between the two treatments? So this is just to know that it is called statistical significant difference, right? The point estimate and its confidence interval, or when we're talking about the 95% confidence interval, it answers that what is the size of that treatment difference and how precisely did this trial determine or estimate the treatment difference. So this is how we are trying to use these two terminologies to answer our research question or answer or interpret the analysis that we have done into our study. Now, if you see that confidence interval or p-value, it is often useful for both statistical measures to be reported in scientific articles, because they're complementary to each other. And if you see the recent articles, especially the randomized controlled trials or the systematic review and meta-analysis, both the values are being reported because they give a lot of information which are complementary to each other. And we are able to understand not only the statistical aspect, but its clinical relevance is also there to be understood. Let's see the p-value a little in more detail. Now, when we say the p-value, whatever the p-value is, basically it measures the effect of chance within a study. It is not the probability that the result of study is true or correct. We are not going to interpret from the p-value. It is just that what is happening, whether it has happened by chance or not. So when we say 0.05, is 5% that the difference which has existed between them, probably it has happened by 5% of that. The chance is just 5%. 95% it appears to be correct. It is not saying that, yes, group A is better than group B. Clinical relevance is not being calculated from this. For example, if we perform a methodologic perfect study of the effect of beta blockers on mortality in heart failure and find a relative risk for death of 0.75 in treated patients and the p-value is 0.03, this means that if there were no effect of beta blockers, we would have expected to get a relative risk of less than 0.75 only 3% of the time. So this is what that anything which has happened by chance is being denoted by the p-value. P-value says nothing directly about the probability that we are actually interested in, the probability that beta blocks actually work, or the probability that the relative risk is really 0.75. It is just that how much is the reason, how much is the chance that it, that, how much is the value that it is happening by chance. And that's why it has been used in various terminology has been mentioned that highly significant or strong evidence of not significant based on the values that are achieved here. Now, how should we express these things? For example, let's see a sample of 100 observations of height of a man drawn at random from a large population. And suppose the sample mean is found to be 175 centimeter among these men with a standard deviation of 10 centimeter. So once we have this data with some p-value, can we make any statement about the population mean? We cannot say that the population mean is 175 centimeter in the as such in the whole population, because we are uncertain as to how much sampling fluctuation has occurred. What we do instead is to determine a range of possible values for population mean with 95 degree of confidence. So this means that if we repeat these studies multiple times, say 20 times, and we found that that range will give that in 19 studies, the value which will be calculated from these studies will lie in that range. And this is what is being deciphered from the confidence interval. So this means a point estimate from a sample population may not reflect the true value among the population from which we have sampled our study. So this means the observed value from our study may not be the true value in the population. So this means just knowing the mean and its p-value is not enough to understand the data that we have achieved. And what we can do for it? So if we can have a range that I've just mentioned, which is usually in the form of confidence interval, it gives a boundaries of the values within which there is high probability. And we assume we cannot say 100% because for 100%, it has to be a global data. So we accept 95% by convention. So we say that this is the range in which if we repeat the study multiple times, the 95% time, the true value will lie somewhere in this range. And that will be of more of a clinical significance for us. And this is how what I mean here, that if you repeat the studies 20 times, 19 times, your value will come in that range, which is called as 95% confidence interval. By conventionally, we assume it to be a 95% confidence interval, but we can go up at 90% confidence interval or 99% confidence interval. And that is based, that is again related to the alpha level that we have an assumption when we start our study, which is acceptable to us. But remember, having said that, now we have understood what P means and what the confidence interval means it. Let's see that how in clinical practice or clinical understanding of various studies, we should be a little considerate. Now, when we have some p-value, we have some statistical significance. We should not be, it does not guarantee the clinical significance. Even if the study is giving a parameter where we say that the p-value is 0.01 or highly statistically significant, it may not be translated into a clinical significance that group A is better than group B, the drug A is better than drug B. Let's see this study. 60,000 heart attack patients found admitted to the hospital on weekdays had a significantly longer hospital stay than those admitted to the hospital on weekends. And p-value here was significant. But if you see the magnitude of difference, it was too small, 7.4 days versus 7.2 days. So if we see our clinical relevance of these in our clinical practice from the clinician point of view, from the financial point of view, this may not be of clinical relevance. So what I mean to say is, that always a statistical significant p-value may not be translated into a clinical significance. So when you interpret your data, though the p-value may be significant, it is not always that it will translate into clinical significance. Hence, you need to interpret your findings accordingly. Let's see another simple example. Time taken for tracheal intubation using CMAC video laryngoscope was significantly less as compared to GlideScope, and P value was again significant here. Again, the magnitude was just 4 seconds for a normal airway, and that too within a limit of 14 plus versus 18 seconds. So again, this may not be of a clinical significance for us, though the p-value was quite statistically significant. So this means the clinically unimportant effects may be statistically significant if a study is large and therefore has a small standard error and extreme precision. And sometimes these p-values, I was talking earlier about the sample size, if you keep it too large, the p-value may be highly significant, but again, it may not translate into statistically significant. Let's say this study, once again, if we talk about comparison of CMAC versus GlideScope, and if you see here, though the p-value may be significant, but if you see the 95% confidence interval here, they are overlapping each other. Though the p-values see significant and the mean values are showing some difference, though it was not clinically significant, but if you try to look for the other parameter which is complementary to each other, the 95% confidence interval, which is again statistically analyzed, it will show that probably this is again, from this point of view, there is no much difference in using this type of laryngoscope. The other important understanding when we talk about these p-values is that the association does not equal causation when we try to analyze it. So when we say there is some statistically significance comes on comparison, it does not imply a cause-effect relationship. As I mentioned at the beginning, it is just what he's saying is in the context of something happening by chance. So you interpret it just in the context of the study design here. The third aspect is, I initially mentioned about the sample size, which is based on the primary objective. And sometimes we try to do say subgroup analysis and try to analyze those data. But remember, our original primary objective was based on certain sample size. The sample was for that particular thing, not for the subgroups that we have generated. Let's see this interesting study. 1073 heart patients, they were divided into groups but treated the groups equally. So obviously there should not be a difference. But then these almost 1100 patients were divided into 18 subgroups based on prognostic factors. And then they find that certain groups were significant among each other. Now, since there was no treatment, and what just we did subgroup of these 1100 old patients into 18 subgroups, how the significance would have come in. And this is what the limitation of multiple testing or subgroup testing is, that if we try to know subdivide our data collected into groups and subgroups and try to get some significant p-value, yes, this torture will give us some p-value and we'll be happy. But remember that what we assumed is the statistics works on certain assumptions. The randomization has been done, blinding has been done, is the sample size calculation has been done. We have assumed a significance level of 0.05, but that is for the primary objective, for the single test. But if you run more than one test, your false positive rates will be much higher than 5%. For example, say you have done 18 subgroups, and when we try to look for the effect of the multiple testing, the chance of at least one false positive would be 0.6. It is much higher, and which is not acceptable. That's why when we say the multiple testing, which may come from multiple outcomes, multiple predictors, subgroup analysis. So these type of multiple testing, we should be a little cautious when we are trying to use this statistical analysis to interpret our results, because the p-value may not be the true p-value for these patients because we have calculated based on the sample size earlier. The other understanding is the consideration of the high type 2 error. The results that are not statistically significant should not be interpreted as evidence of no effect, but it should be considered as no evidence of effect. So this is an important aspect because studies may miss effects if they are insufficiently powered or lack succession. Hence, we should be cautious, and the study design should be adequately powered and report approximate study power if the results are null. And this is very, very important. The other aspect is the fallacy of comparing statistical significance. Sometimes we design a study design, which is a two-group design, which has to be compared. But sometimes we think of statistical significance in one group, pre and post, and the lack of statistical significance in another group, and which is may not be a significant difference between the groups. So this is again a little considered because it is not matching. That's why I mentioned earlier that when you do a statistical analysis, your study design should be appropriate, and your analysis, interpretation, and the application of statistical tool is based on a study design. If it is a two-group design, you cannot have a one-group analysis to result something. For example, in a placebo-controlled randomized trial of a DHA oil for eczema, researchers found that a statistically significant improvement in the DHA group, pre and post, but not in the placebo group. And they conclude that DHA, but not the controlled treatment, resulted in a significant clinical improvement of ectopic eczema. But remember that this was a two-group study. All assumptions were two-group. So this means the improvement in the treatment group was not significantly better than the improvement in the placebo group. So this is actually a null result, and we should be cautiously explaining these results. The other aspect is I was mentioning about the sample size. Remember that we do calculate the sample size, but if you take your sample size too large, the significance or the statistical significance will be elaborated, and you will find that the p-value may be having a very low p-value will be signified if sample size is too large, and hence even the minor effects will be elaborated in these with regards to the p-values, and hence you should be careful when interpreting the results from hypothesis testing when the sample size is too large. Because any small departure from the hypothesized value will probably be detected, and even when the difference is of little or no practical significance. Hence, you should be cautious when you are considering your sample size calculations. Let's see this example. The following finding of a non-significance in a clinical trial of 178 patients, there were two treatments, treatment A and treatment B, where they found out the success and failure rates of a particular interventions, that is treatment A and B. And they found that when they compared, it was p-value was more than 0.1. This means there was no significant value. That is, there is no difference in the efficacy between the treatment A and treatment B. But this is not sufficient. Now, let's see how we further can elaborate on this. Now, the observed difference among these treatment A and treatment B was found to be around 9%. And when we try to elaborate it and have a 95% confidence interval for the difference in the treatment outcome, it was from minus 4% to 22%. So rather than just adding at point more than 0.1, probably we could have had that the treatment B, the treatment A has at best an appreciable advantage of 22%, and at the worst a slight disadvantage of minus 4%. So this will give you understanding of the outcome that you are receiving from treatment A and treatment B, and probably this inference is more informative than just saying that the difference is non-significant as p is more than 0.1. So this is how we need to interpret our data. Let's see another example. Another study with where they have found treatment A and B with success failures, and again they have a p-value of 0.01, which is highly significant. If we see the difference here is 22%, and if we see the 95% CI, it ranges from 6% to 38%. So probably this will indicate that changing from treatment B to treatment A, which was a study, can result in 6% to 38% more patients being cured. So this means this is giving us more information, and the readers will be able to grasp the outcome of the study much better rather than saying that just the study was highly significant. The various interpretations of 95% confidence interval, I think in a very gross language, we can say that we are 95% sure that the true parameter value, if we repeat the study, is in the 95% confidence interval. Or in other language, we can say, if we repeat the experiment many times, 95% of the time, the true parameter value will be in the interval. So this will give us a fair idea that from one study to other study, a similar study conducted with a similar method section, there will be some change in the mean values, observed values, but the true value will be something different. So this 95% CI will help us to understand that this is the range for this particular study, for this particular intervention, that the probably the true value will lie somewhere in between. But remember, the width of the confidence interval, a narrow CI implies high precision, a wide CI implies poor precision, usually due to inadequate sample size. And also, when we talk about the interval that implies no change or no effect, this means the CI for a difference between two means, does the interval include zero? if the confidence interval for a ratio, for example, the odd ratio, does the interval include one? And based on this, you can imply that there is some significance with regards to this value. Let's see this table format, which will make us understand a little better. If you can see, this red mark is the null value. Green is the range of clinical indifference, and this black arrow by both side arrow is the confidence interval. So if you place it, if your confidence interval is crossing the null value, this means probably there is things are almost similar. There is no difference between the two groups, so you can continue the same way. In case if you think that the confidence interval is crossing the clinical indifference, this means sample size is too small. If you see this type of the representation, where the confidence interval is not crossing the null value, this means the statistic is significant, but there is no practical advantage of using this treatment. But if you think that the CI is not crossing it and the range of clinical indifference is outlines this, this means it is statistically significant and it has of a clinical relevance also, and hence you should change your practice based on this particular study. So to summarize, numbers are not the end. The p-values or the understanding is not sufficient. We need to have a requires critical thinking of adding some additional tools of statistical tool, and we need to have some experience to interpret the data with regards to clinical inference so that we can say that this group is better than the other group. So thank you so much for this, and we'll be taking the question answer session after the two talks. In continuity, let me invite Dr. Narayana Yaddanapudi, who will be talking yet on very important session of gap analysis, which is one of the important understanding tool of various research methodology, which will be helping us in clinical understanding of various research aspects. So may I welcome Dr. Narayana for his talk of gap analysis. Dr. Narayana is a professor at PGIMR Chandigarh. I know that he is one of the don in research methodology. He is our teacher, and he has been teaching and training a lot of research methodology section. He is in charge of DM critical course at PGIM Chandigarh, and he has I can say that he has wonderful understanding. It's really a pleasure to listen to him with regards to the research aspects. So over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Garg, for that flattering introduction. All right. I would like to share my screen, if I may, now. Okay. Can you see my screen now?
Yes, sir. It's visible, sir.
All right. Thank you. Now, when an anesthetist hears the word gap analysis, he starts thinking of blood gases and starts thinking of anion gap. So, but that is not what we're going to talk about here. Gap analysis is a term that I first came across when I was looking after the computerization of PGI. This is a management technique. When we first started this software, computerization of PGI, we had a survey of all the software requirements. Then it took about a couple of years before we secured funding. So we had to do a gap analysis between what we projected at the beginning and what is the current requirement. So basically, a gap analysis is a method of assessing the performance of an organization or a system to determine whether the organizational requirements or objectives are being met, and if not, what steps should be taken to meet them. This gap analysis is also many times referred to as needs analysis, needs assessment, or need gap analysis. As you can see, this is just a matter of words. How do we use gap analysis? Gap analysis is used as a starting point for an action plan to produce operational improvement. It helps in benchmarking actual business practices. I'm saying business here because Alcedentin Healthcare is a business, though we are in a teaching, a lot of us are in teaching hospitals. It is still a business. We still have to answer money. Actual business performance, so it can be measured against optimal performance levels. And it helps in documenting services and functions that have been accidentally left out, which have been deliberately eliminated, which may need to be developed now. And then there are lots of regulations. If you are looking at hospital standards, you have to have, there are benchmarks for a number of hospitals. You have got this laboratory certification. Similarly, you have got other things are also regulated. So we need to see whether the hospitals are meeting those requirements or not. Now, broadly, there are two types of gap analysis. One is called a market gap analysis. This basically can be geographically based. For example, I would say no one north of Delhi is doing heart transplants. Now, that is a geographic point. Or it could be a product based. We have got sob panels available now. Shortness of breath panels costs a few thousands of rupees. And any patient who comes with shortness of breath gets tested for 5 different parameters. And the resident doesn't even have to touch the patient. They will know whether the patient has got an MI or anything else such. I find this peculiar, but it is the current action now, currently being done. Or it could be service-based. For example, in PGI, we had started exclusive online registration in the OPDs. But you see, we have got a large number of people who don't have internet access or who don't have the capacity to go online to register. Now, what do? You set up booths to help people to register online. So these are the sort of things, service-based. And then you can talk of better utilization of existing resources. Now, when you set up a computerized registration system and you set up, say, lab samples, barcoding of the lab samples, etc. We can set up barcode printers in every place in the hospital, but that is too expensive. What is a better way of using this? At the admission counter, patients get a couple of pages full of barcode stickers printed and are given to them. So these are the sort of things that can be done by using a gap analysis. Now, strategic gap analysis is to compare yourself with competitors. That I don't think we do too often in medical care, but it is one of the things that we need to look at. Okay, so let me go to what are the benefits of a gap analysis. Insight into areas that need improvement, ensuring that project requirements have been met, finding weaknesses and shortcomings, uncovering differences between perception and reality. It's very easy to deceive oneself. We have got enough things. This we found to be very true in whenever we have applied this methodology in PGI. Providing information to guide decision makers, finding the best places to deploy resources. As I said, we have used this sort of a thing, prioritization of needs, etc. However, one thing that you need to remember is gap analysis has a number of challenges. Successful completion of a gap analysis depends on knowledge and persistence of the people involved in the process. This is very, very difficult to achieve, especially for clinical people to work in this sort of a field is very, very difficult. And one more thing, if we don't analyze deeply enough, we will not find the root causes. And that means we miss the correct solution. We will end up putting a band-aid on a tubercular ulcer. And of course, the analysis can be inaccurate, especially in medicine where the ground is constantly shifting. There are things which are available today which were not available 6 months ago or 1 year ago or 2 years ago. Availability of services, new instruments, new technologies, new medicines, new tests creates the demand for them. So any gap analysis that you do is going to be transiently available, only transiently true. Right. So how do you do gap analysis? Usually a four-step or a five-step process is described. And the steps are, the first step is identify the area to be analyzed and identify the goals to be accomplished. For example, why are daycare OTs not being utilized optimally? So once you say that, you want to next go, not to the current state. Before you go to the current state, you need to define what you want to achieve. What is the ideal, either from your own domain expertise or from a regulatory perspective, what the legal system demands or the hospital policy demands, or what are the service needs of the community. Based on these things, you will need to define what the ideal future state is. Okay. For example, in this case, we would say, we will want to run 8 daily daycare OTs from Monday through Friday. That would be. Then unanticipated difficult hospital admissions would be less than 2%. There will be no mortality, or maybe we can say less than 0.1% or something of that sort. Okay. So, in light of this, analyze the current practices. How do you analyze current practices? You need to get accurate data, accurate measures. That means you need to figure out what are the measures, what are the metrics which actually measure the things that you want to measure. They need to be valid, and you need to, so you need to find what are the key performance indices. So you will go look at the documentation, your records, your protocols that are existing currently. You will find what are the key performance indicators or other success metrics. You will conduct stakeholder interviews. Stakeholders are not just the doctors that you are see that you that deliver the services, that not the technologists that do the testing or the nurses who provide the care. It is everybody, the residents, the faculty, the technicians, the nurses, your safai walas, your transport people, your security people, everybody who is a stakeholder, you will need to conduct interviews with them. What are the problems here? And then you can brainstorm and observe project activities. You can send people with notebooks or those boards, clipboards. They go around just watching what is happening and noting things down. This takes a lot of time and effort, let me tell you that. Okay. So, the fourth step, you compare the target goals against the current state. Again, you need to describe the gap and quantify the difference. It is not, most of the time, it is not just enough to say that these are deficient. You need to quantify how much is the gap, right? Then you decide on, summarize the recommendations and create a plan to bridge the gaps. Here, look, this is, This gap analysis started as a business thing. Therefore, there is a lot of jargon associated with it. Please excuse me for using the jargon. Some of it will be very irritating. For example, the outcomes, the goals that you need to set up are supposed to be specific, measurable, achievable, relevant, and time-bound. So they call them SMART goals. Okay? You need to assign an owner to each part of the process to ensure that you complete each step. If you don't set up attainable goals, your organization is not going to use them, right? you should also be willing to dig deep into the proposed solution. You will find it may not be easy to achieve. You have to sometimes think out of the box to figure out a new solution, right? But how do you do these things? So you develop what is called a gap analysis template, which defines what is the current state, list the processes, workflows, and characteristics, then future state. This column defines what are the outlets of the target condition, and the gap description is this, and then you propose the possible solutions and you work through all these things. You should use a gap analysis template. In addition to that, for each phase of this gap analysis, number of tools are available for you. Again, these are mostly business tools. Some of them are not, but many of them are. Okay. The tools that are available include McKinsey 7S framework, SWOT analysis, Nadler-Tushman model of transformation, decision trees, fishbone diagrams or Ishikawa diagrams, PEST analysis. McKinsey 7S framework basically uses this system. There are 7 S's: strategy, structure, systems, staff, style, and skills, all of them having a superordinate goals or shared values. This system is used to determine specific aspects of an organization that are meeting expectations through the lens of 7 people-centered groupings. This was devised by the business organization of McKinsey. This is mainly used at the time of when you are analyzing the current state and the future, and trying to find the gap analysis. But it is mostly useful for analyzing the current state. SWOT analysis is another method, which basically uses 4 categories: two helpful and 2 harmful, and 2 internal and 2 external: strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. I won't go too much into detail. SWOT analysis has become very popular in various fields, and a lot of people are familiar with it. The Nadler-Tushman model of transformation looks at any organization as a system which transforms inputs into outputs. So we have got the input and we have got the expected output, and this is the transformation process that the organization uses on the inputs to get the desired outputs. So this is, it analyzes the organization's operating system as one that transforms inputs into outputs, basically using 3 categories: input, that is the operational environment, tangible and intangible resources, and the organizational culture. Transformation is the existing systems, people, and project activities currently in place that convert into input into output. And the output is can be at a system level, at a group level, or at the individual level. Decision trees are very good at developing the plans, how to bridge the gap. The decision trees are very good for that. Where did I go? Yes, I'm sorry. I decided to have a bit of fun, and so I started using this mind map to present instead of a PowerPoint presentation. And so I'm a bit, please excuse me. decision tree, elements of decision tree are, there is a decision node, there are choices, and each decision is branching out. It doesn't have to be a binary decision tree. There can be multiple branches at any, at every node, decision node. And that leads on to end decision, the end points, outcomes. These are called the leaf nodes. Now, so these are very good at exhaustively listing all the decisions that need to be taken to achieve a particular outcome. A tree will start from one point, but will have multiple endpoints. You can build a decision tree top down on a paper or left to right, depending on the depth of your branches, number of branches and depth of branches. The order in which you apply conditions matters. So you need to start with conditions that apply to most scenarios. And as you narrow down the scenario, use conditions that are specific to that particular branch only. At each decision point, all possible alternatives have to be listed. There should be no overlap. And there should be no gaps. And you can get outcomes not at the same three branch depth in every branch. It can be at the second level in one, third level in another, 11th level at another one. And then this is just a way of how to make sure that it looks good, understandable. So here is an example of a decision tree to decide what type of cataract contact lens to be advised to a patient. You need to look at the tear production rate. If it is reduced, please don't add contact lenses. If there is astigmatism, look at the age. If the patient is presbyopic, you avoid giving contact lenses. If the patient is not presbyopic, you can add a soft. Similarly, spectacle prescription, myopes and hypermetropes, and then again age. As you can see, this is complete. Decision trees are good at making the plans for a gap, bridging the gap. Fishbone diagrams, on the other hand, are very good at defining the gap. These are originally devised by a Japanese business professor, Ishikawa. So here you have a outcome here. This is what you desire. And you see all the processes that affect that. At each step, you can define in each of the herringbone patterns, each of the ribs, you can write out what are the problems involving that particular category, what are the current status, how this is affecting the project, the outcome. So this is very good at root cause analysis or finding out what the gaps are actually. And commonly used categories are these: measurements, materials, people, machines, methods, and environment. But you can use whatever is good for that particular problem. Then PEST or PESL analysis is something that is, again, makes you, helps you make sure that you deal with comprehensively list out all the problems that are possible. PEST stands for political problems, economic problems, sociological problems, and technological problems. In many industries and even in healthcare, we will need to look into this legal and environmental problems. For example, our fluorocarbons. For example, our brain death declaration, denying life care, access to health care. These are the sort of things that we need to look at. Again, it is another way of making sure that you deal with all the problems that are possibly present. So I'll give you some examples. Yeah, where these sort of the gap analysis will be useful. For example, when you are trying to start a new service, such as opening a new block of hospital with new operation theaters, productivity, for example, if your daycare surgery theaters are running only at half capacity, how do you get to full capacity? Maybe that patients don't know about it. Patients may have problems about pre-anesthesia clinic. They may have problems about communication problems. Patients, we have two rigid categories of things that need to be there before we start the, we allow the patient to undergo and take a surgery. It might be that that the surgeons don't have enough personnel. There can be any number of things from one end to the other. Supply management, for example, if your blood gas machines are running out of supplies in the and have to be, you need to get emergency authorization to buy new consumables, there is something wrong with your supply management. You might want to use gap analysis to find out where exactly these problems are occurring so that you can rectify those things. Individual assessments, you can get your residents or your faculty to do a gap analysis about themselves, about how, about their productivity, what they want to achieve, what they are, what is their current state, right? And you can develop team goals using that. Service evaluation, again, how your department is functioning, you can do that. So this is all fine, but can I publish these things? After all, you guys are sitting in a research methodology workshop. Is anybody going to read? Can I publish these things in any reputable journal? Is anybody going to read these things? Yes, they are going to do that. And Indians have been writing a lot of these gap analysis. For example, you have got this Ariaga et al. In Anaesthesiology 2019. Failure to debrief after critical events in anesthesia is associated with failures in communication during the event. And what are the methods they have used? They have used stakeholder interviews, audit, and quantitative qualitative analysis. And I won't talk about too much about this, but look at the journal it is published. It is published in our topmost journal, Anesthesiology. Right? Then, Ravi et al., systematic analysis of authorship demographics in global surgery. This is a major gap among, for example, they basically used bibliometric analysis. And what did they find? That they found in surgical literature, the majority of authors are coming from the high income countries. And there is a gender gap in global surgery authorship. And this is at higher levels at senior people and among the lower and middle income countries authors. The gender gap in middle authors are first author, last author, and the middle authors. The first author is probably the guy who actually did the work. The last author is the guy who probably is the head of the lab. So middle authors are the ones who contributed in some extent. The gender gap in the middle authors is greater in studies co-authored with HIS countries. For example, have a look at this. As you can see, the highest number of authors are from here, first authors. Lowest are southern countries. India is somewhere here. Last authors, again, similar distribution, right? So this shows a gap and we can deal with it, right? They have suggested some measures to get rid of these, mitigate these problems. Then Radma et al., BMG open. Post-operative handover, focus group interview study. Here you can see the technique they used was focus group interviews. They have used, these are the major findings, categories of problems that they have. And funnily enough, the interventions needed were identified, these were not just education, etc. They were also the environmental infrastructure changes were needed. This is an unexpected finding. Then we have Melanie et al. Analgesics for dental implants, a systematic review. And here they used a systematic review and they found knowledge gaps among the people who were prescribing analgesics. Mike et al., reducing the knowledge to action gap in hospital nutrition care, printed in 2020 clinical nutrition, right? They used techniques of audit, stakeholder analysis, feedback. And the outcomes they have found, they have developed a new audit questionnaire, new action-oriented feedback and benchmarking report, and they managed to get a unit-level personalizable action plan template. Anderson et al., defining the anesthesia gap for reproductive health processes in resource-limited settings, International Journal of Gynecology. Again, bibliographic analysis, and this is their finding. Basil et al., gender composition and trends in Journal of Cardiothoracic and Vascular Anesthesia editorial board memberships. So we are finding gaps between high-income countries and low-income countries, between genders at every level, at the authorship level, at the editorial board composition. For example, look at this. This is over a period of years. This is the share of female editorial board members compared to male editorial board members. This is from AIMS. Patient blood management in India, review of current practices and feasibility of applying appropriate standards of care guidelines. This is again a questionnaire-based survey and a consensus assessment based on evidence. Again, identified the gaps. Then Chen et al., global distribution of publications in anesthesia. And you will find, interestingly enough, the maximum number of publications, the size of the dot tells you which countries have got the highest. If you look at that, and then you look at the number of publications and correlation with GDP. As you can see at the right at the top is USA, and India is, where is India? Here. Right, and China is catching up. And I believe after this has been published, China has actually overtaken USA. Neurocritical care, gender parity analysis of grants and recognition of awards. Again, you will find that in neurocritical care, this is it. Once in 2011 and once in 2019, some women were given some awards. Rest of the time, no. We would not even think about this until these things were published. Srivastava et al. Is again from a person who was in AIMS. Newborn thermal care in Western UP. These guys actually did put feet on the road and did the work. Knowledge about newborn thermal care and practices and the gap between these two were devised. So, doing this set of research can be very rewarding. You can actually publish it, and you can publish it in major journals, international journals. However, I would like to end with one law, Goodhart's law. Goodhart's law says, when a measure becomes a target, it ceases to be a good measure. If we target patient satisfaction as the only thing, we will end up pampering patients and not doing what is good for them. We will do what is. If we decide that ratings of the teachers by the students is what is important, we will end up doing what makes them happy rather than what is needed. So a measure, any KPI should not be taken alone. It is a multidimensional methodology, and we need to remember that. Thank you.
Dr. Rakesh?
Yes, sir.
I think kindly introduce the next speaker.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir. We'll move to the next session, which is another interesting session of critical appraisal of the published paper. And this is by none other than Dr. Anju Grewal, who is one of the pioneer in research. She is a professor and head of the department at Dayanand Medical College and Hospital, Ludhiana. She has a special interest in obstetric anesthesia, CPR, airway management, trauma anesthesia, and scientific communication. She has been the past editor-in-chief of Journal of Anesthesiology and Clinical Pharmacology. She is vice president RSCCP and also the national secretary for Association of Obstetric Anesthesiologists. She is associate editor for International Journal of Regional Anesthesia. She is coordinating the AHA training site at EMCH. She is founder member of Member Airway Management Foundation. And she has many scientific publications in national and international journal. When we read a paper, it has to be critically appraised with various aspects, which is very, very important, not from only the purpose of researcher, but also from the point of view as a clinician. And let me request Dr. Anju Grewal to speak on this topic, critical appraisal of an article published. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Am I audible?
Yeah, ma'am, you're audible, ma'am.
Thank you. So I think I'll quickly wind up. I know dinner is just a gap between my talk and so would like to, you know, take you through the steps of critical appraisal of an article published. And as Dr. Rakesh very rightly said, you know, we have a plethora of articles being published every day. You know, as new journals come in, that this whole process is getting too much overloaded. So that information overload that we have, we really need to, you know, look at them and see that what are the kind of articles that are going to influence my practice into clinical arena. So it is basically, if I were to, you know, just speak in the words of Burles, the process of carefully and systematically examining research to judge its trustworthiness, its value, relevance in the particular context. You know? And I'd like to give you an overview. You know, I was quite tempted to pick up an article, published article, but then I refrained so because I don't want to get into any controversies with any of the editors up there and the authors. But we as clinicians need to actually develop this skill because we need to understand what is useful, what is flawed. And with, you know, promotions being guided by publications, we are, of course, need the skill more in a more precision manner. And the whole aim is that we do not want any harm coming to our patients just because we adopted practices from one of the flawed research. So we need to select and appraise this literature to which is relevant to our field. And as I said, we need to understand what are the implications to my individual patients? What is the kind of setup that I'm working in? What are my logistics? What are my limitations and my, you know, facilities that I have, my patients' preferences, and then that should guide appropriate management plans. So if I were to define the definition of a critical appraisal, basically it is an application of rules of evidence to a study to assess one, validity of data, completeness of reporting, methods and procedures used by that particular group of researchers, the conclusions that they have drawn from their results, and of course, compliance with ethical standards. And with the type of study, evidence rules would vary differently. So there's no gold standard way. However, there are certain core questions that we really need to answer whenever we look to a question, to a study. And I think before we go to these questions, it's important to first look at the title and the abstract. And that actually tells you in which direction is this paper actually moving, right? And we need to look at the study is to see whether it has a scientifically interesting and relevant research question. And when I talk about relevance, the relevance is always in parlance to your clinical scenario, okay? Will the study outcome provide a clinical significance to the reader or add something new? We remember that we are not in times where, you know, we will have some path-breaking research or discoveries, but we really need to continue to see whether the available evidence. Sometimes studies would actually just look at the results of a particular study and see if they can be, you know, translated to their particular demographic profile or clinical scenario, or can they be generalized to a larger population? So there would be, we really need to look at what the study outcome the research is looking at. And is the methodology well designed for the research question? And therefore, we need to acutely look at the research question. Is it well framed? What is the research question? And is the methodology in consonance with the research question? Because we all know that there are many biases, confounders, which will skew the results either way, right? And of course, have a primary outcome been defined and properly evaluated, and something that has been dealt very well nicely by Dr. Rakesh, talking about validity, talking about significance, sample sizes, meaningful differences or effect sizes, all of these need to be understood well. And therefore, we all need to look at them holistically and also look at conflicts of interest. So all of these questions are something that should be in the mind of a critical appraisal clinician when they look at that. So we'll just broad steps. When you look at the introduction, after your abstract comes your introduction section. And it is this section where we should be able to, after reading that, able to identify a clear research question, which clearly states the objectives and the clinical relevance that this research would lead to. So there has to be a need, a purpose, some kind of background literature, which clearly lays out what are we trying to, what this researcher is trying to actually query or hypothesize, and are the conclusions given above in the abstract section in consonance to what they are talking about, the objectives and the hypothesis or not. And as I said, very importantly is the design of the study. Once we know the research question, the design of the study needs to be appropriate to the research question, and there should be a hypothesis stated before the study protocol or the methodology begins, which of course can be tested or refuted, something that can be. So just to give you an overview of, your research question, think about the research question that the investigator is trying to ask. Does it involve exposures? If yes, you are actually working on the experimental study pathway. And then you need to look at how was allocation of subjects done, which will lead you whether it's a randomized or a non-randomized study. If there are no assigned exposure, you're actually looking at exposures that are already there in the patient, it is basically an observational study. And then depending upon whether a comparator was used, we would ascribe them into analytical study or descriptive studies. So on the basis of this kind of a flow chart, we can kind of find out whether the research question and the study design are in consonance to each other or not. And very important is to evaluate the methodology. A methodology is actually, I always say it's like a recipe. If you were to take the ingredients of this methodology and replicate it in your setup, you should actually end up getting the similar kind of results. As Dr. Rakesh said, we should be able to be in the similar kind of 95% confidence intervals. So we need to look at the methodology and see, has the researcher used the PCOT tool if suppose they're doing a randomized controlled trial? Is there a patient population defined, and is it similar to yours? Is the intervention, what kind of interventions have been planned, and would, what would you like to do? And did they compare it with a placebo or with some other group? And did they clearly specify outcomes? And what are the kind of outcomes that you're looking at in your patients as well when you're reading the study? So for this, we need to pay a detailed attention to the trial description. What was the patients selected, the interventions? A lot of stress has to go into randomization. How were subjects randomized? Were the study investigators aware or unaware of the patient allocation, or did they have any control over randomization? Now, this is very important because most of the studies do mention in inverted commas randomized controlled trial, but often what we see on ground is that randomization is not done in a consensuous manner as it should be done, and therefore it actually creates a bias and tends to favor the study group, and therefore there is a deviation in the study results which may be misinterpreted by us as clinicians and may cause harm to your patients. Also blinding, if it has been done, has it been properly defined? What are the primary and the secondary? And remember, there should be just one primary outcome, and based on which a sample size should be calculated which, you know, you should be able to tell you what kind of effect size are we looking at with this group of participants in this particular study. So just to, you know, summarize the key methodological points for randomized control trials, was the process of treatment allocation truly random? This is something that really needs to be addressed. Sometimes the literature, the wordings, the kind of the way it has been worded, you know, the grammar is so fluent that you can tend to hide the actual true allocation. But if you go through the results and you go through the whole process of the methodology, you would be able to see whether random allocation was truly done or not. Would participants be able to know or guess their treatment allocation? Were participants or researchers blinded to treatment groups? Were the outcomes assessed objectively? What are the tools? Are they valid tools? And, you know, if the participants who were randomly allocated or they were the dropouts, all of them are being accounted in the final analysis. And, you know, how are they doing the data analysis? This is very strong, extremely important. And very much important is the point that during your research, I would say in the part of your protocol, as well as in the published literature, the methodology of statistical analysis should always be clearly defined. We must be able to define why we are choosing a sample size, what is our level of significance, are we kind of, you know, looking at data that has violated the normal distribution, and how have we kind of tested them, and, you know, we're making sure that we are interpreting them in the correct manner. And there could be multiple studies, so they're just, you know, few key pointers, I would say, to look at your type of study and then look at what are the kind of things that we really need to look at during appraisal. Say in a cohort study, is it a prospective or a retrospective study? Have they defined a group or a population? What are the confounding factors? So you see, confounding factors become a very important determinant in actually telling us how accurately and objectively we are looking at our outcomes, and also to look at, you know, what kind of follow-ups and data losses, and of course length of time. So all of these things, they kind of give us a guide on how to critically analyze various types and designs of study. Okay, and the next very important part is to evaluate the result. And as we all know that the results should only entail findings without any attempt to interpret them in the result section. The total number of participants, including, you know, with the number excluded, dropped out, withdrawn, should be done so. Because if we are not doing so, there is a possibility of underestimation or overestimation. The researcher should be able to provide you actual values, including mean with standard deviation or error. And, you know, if in some cases, median and interquartile range, there should be completeness of all the variables and with appropriate statistical tests. And, you know, we must also look at the paper to see that the findings are similar everywhere in the article. Sometimes there are different findings in the results section as compared to what they're given in the tables or mentioned in the discussion section. And discussion section is one where we must be able to see whether the researcher has actually accounted for or reasoned out the outcomes of the study, looked at any dropouts or change in methodology, commented on external validity, looked at their limitations, compared their findings in the correct in a perspective to the previous literature findings, and then, of course, you know, concluded what they have found and not just what they interpret. So that's extremely important when we are reading this paper. And to do all of this, you know, is a lot of checklists are available. And we know we have all of these reporting, you know, consort, quorum, all of these reporting guidelines for various types of studies. But there is a critical appraisal skills program, which actually gives you a lot of tools and checklists. So just, you know, got to did I lose my, am I audible and visible right now?
Ma'am, your slide, yeah, audible, ma'am, visible, ma'am.
So just on my last slide, I think very early on in our careers, we must encourage our postgraduates, especially when they do their journal clubs, to use a structured checklist so that they develop the critical appraisal skills early on. And as I said, the title and an abstract are your starters, whether you want to really look at this paper in conjunction to your clinical, you know, scenario or your clinical decision or your clinical dilemma that you have. And of course, the research question, the hypothesis, the study design, which is commensurate to your research question, the methodology, the analysis, and the results are something that are the main course of your critical appraiser. And we really need to focus on all of these and, you know, decide on whether this paper would impact your clinical decision-making or not. So thank you so much for a patient hearing. And I believe we all stand on the shoulders of giants as we do our researches. And we continue to critically appraise ourselves and you know, take ourselves to a better platform where we can collate all these data critically and make a difference to our patients. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for this interesting session. And I think you have made it very clear that what we need to look for when we are looking for a published paper so that we can accept into our clinical practice. Can I request Devilina to share if there are any questions in the Q&A in the chat of this WhatsApp, please, of this Zoom, please?
I don't see any questions there in the QA column. Probably the presentations were so good, so that there's nothing left for the audience to ask anything. You seem to be traveling.
Can I have a question, sir?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, my question is to Dr. Narayana. You know, we, as part of NABH, we do a lot of audits. So I just wanted to understand, is audit a part of gap analysis, or you know, can it replace gap analysis?
An audit can be a part of the gap analysis at different stages. It can definitely, it definitely tells you the current state. It doesn't talk about the future state. Future state. So you have the current state. Audit can tell you what the current state is. The future state you have got to define. Based on these two, you can definitely find out what the gaps are, right? And develop a plan. Audit cycle sort of implies that you have, that you do a gap analysis based on the audit, but it doesn't explicitly say so. And gap analysis has got its own methodology, specifically for developing the outcome matrix and for developing plans to bridge the gap. There are great tools for that. So audit is part of gap analysis, I would say.
Sir, can you just tell us, Dr. Narayana, how can we put into our clinical practice? I mean, can you just explain with a couple of examples as to clinical practice? You have already mentioned in your presentation also the core current areas that we need to look for in the present scenario, because nowadays, when we are looking for the patient's outcomes, those features,
there is some lot of disturbance on the line. I don't know why.
There certainly is.
Okay. Now, if I understand you, Dr. Garg, you are asking me what are the possible roles of gap analysis in the current anesthesia practice. And I would say there are many. You, for example, I will talk about from my perspective. Okay. We have just recently activated a new block of hospital with 8 operation theaters. So we needed to figure out what are the goals for that operation, those operation theaters. What surgeries, what type of surgeries, how many, what are the outcomes, do we have the resources to take care of the patients post-operatively, you know, that is one aspect of it. So starting a new service, you need to we have a tendency to just say, oh, the building is there, we have got the anesthesia machine, we'll just post a resident there and we'll start the case. That is not how it should be done. So we should do a proper, before starting a new service, we will need to look at this. Then the other thing, the improvement of the current work, current practices. If you have, we have our performance metrics in the ICU intensive care mostly, the CLABSI rates, the VAP rates, the fall rates. We can use those to do a gap analysis and get to where we need to be. I'm sure we are not there. Similarly, we have a standard audit cycle running continuously in the ICU about the antibiotic, antimicrobial resistance organisms and all that. We do that all the time. So this is again type of gap analysis that we do every day, right? Every month. So that's one more thing. Then, as I said earlier about increasing the capacity of an existing service, such as our day, all the examples that I have given are from PGI and from what we have done actually. So, so daycare OTs, we have the daycare OTs, we had the equipment, we have, but the surgical specialties didn't have their equipment. There were OT lights were getting delayed, or then you have different specialties, internecine fighting among the different specialties. The surgical head gives the subspecialty people a table on the day that they have their OT, OPD. So these sort of things you need to figure out how to get rid of. These are again gaps in the service, right? So all these are candidates, daily candidates, right?
So as I understand, even a running operating room can be a subject of gap analysis.
Absolutely, absolutely. For example, we have another project going on, a thing going on in, we don't usually publish these things, unfortunately, but we should. We have a running thing going on in our post-anesthesia care unit. How many patients are going at what ALDRED score level and what is happening to them, etc. What type of cases are coming back or getting admitted to the ICU? You know, a running service can be a continuous gap analysis project. Yeah.
I think that's useful because we can, as you mentioned about the audit cycle also and various gaps, I think that will be translated into improving the patient care. So this should be a routine part of assessment of our services that we are doing it. Plus, as you rightly mentioned that if you're planning to have new services, so that will give us a fair idea that what to look for.
Actually, so much, you know, yeah. Actually, I would really like that, you know, NMC and, you know, even thesis protocol committees approve these kind of things for even, you know, projects for even students, because that is how they get into a quality improvement process and also, you know, learn the nitty-gritty of improving their own services in their own places. I don't know how far I'm a little futuristic, but I believe
it is so difficult. It is so difficult for these committees to change their guidelines. Mm-hmm. At a DM level, you mm-hmm. want the candidate to do something like a systematic review as a project, mm-hmm. and they refuse to let us do it. Okay.
Yes.
So there are problems. We have to keep plugging at it.
I think there is some gap in the minds of the people who are sitting there and learn, but that's where the root cause of the whole problem is. I mean, unless we fill up that gap, we can't have this thing. I appreciate the feeling which Dr. Anju expressed that I'm futuristic. Great, wonderful. You know, one should be futuristic. One should look ahead with a positive mind. But until and unless the people at the top who actually matter, they don't come into this, I think we will be sort of in our efforts to improve the system. But it doesn't mean that we should not keep trying. We must keep trying.
We must, sir. We must. Well said.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
So So
I think Rakesh, I think there are no more questions, sir. And the session, both sessions were good. So I think it's dinner time also. So can I request Dr. Baljeet Singh, sir, to give a word of thanks?
I will do that. Thank you so much. I think all three talks are so very wonderful. Dr. Rakesh Garg started with the p-values and the confidence intervals. And I think the confidence with which he spoke about confidence intervals reflects the depth of knowledge that he has. He has the depth of knowledge in every area, whether it is statistics or it is research or whatever. Anyhow, hats off to him. Very well done. And Dr. Narayana Yaddanapudi, this was something, honestly saying, Dr. Narayana, there were some gaps which I also had in my mind, and I think I filled up some of the gaps. It was a wonderful talk, a lot of new avenues of thought process that you have opened up, and I think this will not only lead to a better understanding of the system we live in, it will also lead to improvement, at least at our personal levels. This will certainly be handy, the way which you have explained the gap analysis to be done and how to implement that. And then, of course, it's always a delight to listen to Dr. Anju Grewal, of course, to all three of you. But then, in a very short span, a few slides, he very well explained the critical appraisal of an article that is published. I think these are the kind of things which we lack in a curriculum. And this should be started right from the beginning, right at the level of the postgraduate students, the moment they enter the system, for their post-graduation. And this should start right at that level. They should know how to conduct research, how to plan research, how to design research. Yes, we have thesis, all right, but I think we all know in our heart of hearts that thesis is a mere formality. They somehow, pluck a chapter from there, pluck something there from there, they put it in, and then it is left to the heads of the head of the department or whoever is heading that unit to figure out what he has written and sort of combine them to make it somewhat readable and give a good impression of what it is. We have, I think, some deficiency at that level, and it'll be best served in case the students can be given training right at the time when they enter the post-graduation stream. Thank you so much, all the speakers, wonderful talks, pleasure to listen to all of you, and Dr. Kish, thanks for moderating this. And I think it's, as you all said, it's dinner time, and on behalf of Indian College of Anaesthesiology, the president and my colleague, Dr. Yashiri Sood, I thank you once again, officially, and look forward to having you again on the program to continue with our journey of webinars every Wednesday. And of course, the way it is being received, that's an inspiration for us, that keeps us going. Thank you so much and good night, everyone.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. And good night also. We're closing
here. Bye.
Thank you.